the base field, then on double base connect, which are three dimensional.
Where it agrees with this formula, and there's also the locality of the chiral fermions.
about that, I'll show it to you maybe again. Yeah. We're basically assuming that this medium is large enough to tune the top logical constant without affecting these formulas, which may or may not be true. That's our assumption. These dead genome masses at the gut scale are suppressed. The quantity Q is determined in terms of all of those discrete data of the compactification, and less than one. And after a study of between the discrete nature of continuous parameters, we found that the gravitational mass is smaller than the gravitational mass, I mean 95% of the parameter space, or the landscape. And you can compare that actually with analytics results in the large volume type degree compactification obtained by Conner and Corbello. Since we think the gravitational mass is suppressed, the anomaly radiation contribution is comparable, and typically one finds gravitational masses of 200 GeV or so.
Picture of the walk compactification. One,
trains are wrapping a fourth cycle, which has one direction, which is being warped, one pulse direction. And to get this application, one can switch on gauge instantons on the fourth cycle. So ordinary instantons, which are these three, remember they have a scale. And these are actually found out in D3 brains, inside the 7 brain, parallel to the 7 brain, say. And we actually get a new mechanism for localizing the fermion wave function, because they're localized both by instantons and the warp factor. And given I want to attempt to give an overview of the result, the basic picture is that you power coupling, and we both suppress and enhance by the warp factor, as in the 5D models, but also the instanton scale size enters in those formulas. But Roberto will say a bit more about that in his short presentation. So, let me conclude. We've seen that M-theory and type 2D vacua can have both a hierarchy and moduli stabilization, and we can actually understand this quite rigorously. Using this, it's possible to confront collider data. But once one's done that, one's left with a question. How many other classes of vacua are there with the stabilized hierarchy? Is it an order 1 number, which would be good? Is it, say, 100, or some much larger number? I don't know the answer. My suspicion is it's a small number, but that's an important question. I'll stop there.
Why is it still stabilizing these models?
In type 2A, well, you can do this in type 2A, but the problem is that you have type 2A on a Calabi R-oriented fold with these six brains wrapping three cycles. But then, in type 2A, any two three cycles will generically intersect each other. So the hidden sector gauge group will couple to the standard model gauge group. And so you expect gauge mediation. And I haven't studied the consequences of that.
You want
the type 2A picture of these things? Yes, I mean, this is strongly coupled type 2A. Yeah. I was addressing weakly coupled type 2A. So you can have gauge, it would be a similar picture except you have gauge mediation.
Yeah, so I guess I was going with this. I didn't understand where you were getting the discrete term from, because you answered my first question by saying that you turned off all the fluxes.
Typically, the joules of these are the fluxes that in type 2B. These non-geometric fluxes, metric fluxes, things that we really don't understand in this M-theory corner. And so we're making this assumption, a questionable assumption, that's fine, but there are, if one can make examples of series of vacua, discrete series of vacua in which you have strong gauge dynamics and chiral symmetries and so on, but in which in that series, the cosmological constant is changing by a lot, but the couplings in the gauge sector are not. So there are examples which show that you can adjust the cosmological constant without changing particle physics too much. But whether or not that is true in this corner of the landscape, I don't know. We're assuming that one can simply solve the cosmological constant problem in the old-fashioned way. There's the coefficient of the superpotential, which we take to be order 1. Then there are the homology classes of the three cycles, the various three cycles that are entering. So in this case, it's the gauge three cycle. This thing in the exponent is the gauge coupling function. And these integers are all positive, and we just take them to be order 1. And then there's the rank of the gauge group, which in the example I showed, consider them to be 7 and 8. If you just have pure superangular sectors, then typically the typical vacuum is spontaneously broken supersymmetry with a negative cosmological constant. But we actually study a bit, adding matter fields as well, and depending on the number of flavors, we found the sitter vacuum as well. But they have pretty similar particle physics properties. What happens to it? I mean, it's not that ad hoc, because it has n parameters in it. And we vary these parameters to see what happens. And qualitatively, I even took an extent quantitatively, things are not so sensitive. I don't know what happens if you multiply this. It's conceivable that you could compute the scalar potential of one of these G2 manifolds directly. If you had the right technology for your right idea. And then there'll be some function here of ratios of the moduli theory, and I don't know what would happen.
there's not anything there. It's just modified for just an dimensional reduction.
Manifold, this is the potential. That's a complicated one, or more generic one, I don't know. So that's what's interesting.
The last question. Could you say what you assumed or computed about the gauge coupling, the modulus dependence of the gauge coupling function for those supersymmetric standard model JGNOs?
Well, I think so.
Because you've got light JGNOs, and that's very contingent on, you know, the F terms that are generated by these moduli, which couple to the standard model JGNOs as well.
We didn't assume anything about the gauge coupling function. It's actually it's always generally a positive integer linear combination of all the moduli.
But you have the hidden sector group, right, and you also have a standard model group.
Yeah.
And you're including all of it in that.
Yeah.
So that's not the visible sector.
The visible sector gauge coupling function?
Yes, because we made a thing about the JGNOs.
That takes a very similar form as well.
Right, so how did you get JGNOs that are lighter than expected by the standard special analysis?
So, we don't understand it very well, but you can see when you do the computation, for example, there's a supersymmetric limit in which masses would vanish, and that you see a remnant of that cancellation in the non-supersymmetric capsula. Helping to mention that there are all kinds of factors of pi and so on going around. For example, our hidden factor scale is 10 to the 15 GeV. And the reason that the Maritino mass is a GeV is because of factors of pi and the volume, which effectively reduces it.
And then you set a trace W times A, where A is the joint, and this generates the hierarchy of masses, which are again hierarchy related to the scalar mass, but the hierarchy is then used there. It turns out that one can ask the question if there is a way to avoid this related hierarchy in setup. It turns out that in this case, you can do it in the following way. Suppose that the standard model is localized in a supersymmetric brain, and then you have some gate mediator with large masses by introducing some supersymmetric brain sector, which contains massive hypermultiples, which is in the intersection of the supersymmetric brain sector and the standard model sector. In this case, the limit where the mass of these hypermultiples is less than the string K is then essentially the same result as before, this hierarchy, but the string K is replaced by the mass of the hypermultiples. This is a parameter, it can be different from the string K. Then I can compute the scalar masses, which provide either from one loop of the scalar, which belong in the adjoint of, if you want the partner of, which belong in the adjoint any multiplet, or for the squatter level which can come just from any one intersection, they arrive at two loops, and they have the same scaling, D over M, with the same power of the coupling, so this is a way to plane, to create this hierarchy, and the plane continues to squat for the same order of magnitude. In this case, we should impose, of course, the messages to the hypermultiple to belong in the presentation, such that the trace of the hypertype in every trace of this hypermultiple should be zero in order to avoid any non-big contributions which come directly from the DPM, from the hypertype, which has two parts, one comes from the standard model and one comes from the messages. So this is just because this is the messages belong to complete this side of the presentation. The possibility that gives you that works at the moment, and it seems to give interesting terminology, in particular if you look at the Higgs potential. The Higgs potential receives an additional contribution to the n equal 1 Dn coming from the Fn, so the n equal 2 if you want Dn. So it's, if you analyze it, you find that the light Higgs behaves as the standard model Higgs, in particular as a coupling which is given just by the standard model coupling, while the steady Higgs does not couple to the D and plays a role, and plays no role in the Wiesner space. So I finish with the conclusion. So as you said, the possibility to generate the Higgs mass for 3 years. If the spring scale is high, then you always obtain hierarchy between scalar masses and Higgs masses. In the case of Majorana masses, these are the two types of hierarchies. In the case of the Higgs masses, this is the hierarchy. And however, in this case, there is a way to avoid this problem by introducing a gate mediation scenario with any particular number.
Other questions? In the gravity mediated case, how large is the anomaly mediated contribution?
In which case,
in the gravity mediation case. The anomaly mediated.
But I think you don't find anomaly mediation. I mean, it's just a cancel, I guess, without a contribution, so you find only the final result. This is one of the puzzles.
Can you think about looking at the
difference? I don't think so. I mean, that's what we have to do. I don't think so. I don't think so.
There is one scenario in the second field theory where Kiel's potential has a no scale form, where the anomaly mediation contribution just vanishes. So is that what's going on here?
Okay.
How specific is your assumption that the beginning masses rule of 2W? Does it apply only for neutral trucks, example, or how much energy would apply also for fluctuation specific by trucks or other things?
Well, the better flux is depends, if there is an implicit assumption, calculation of the starting point corresponds to the compression field value. So of course if you put it flat, I don't know how to do it. But the assumption in general has a lot.